Everyone, we are re-recording our sermon from yesterday because of some of the technical issues we were having, a lot of which those we have fairly certainly worked through, and we're also kind of brainstorming some more creative ways to record and publish our content so that it'll be more user-friendly and easier for us to do that. So we are filming this live from our panic room here at the church. This is our kind of our backstage area where we can film some things with our cool green screen, and so we've got this background behind me that will kind of come in handy when we get into the message today. But we've been going through the sermon series called Disciple, the Journey We're Taking, and we're talking about what it means to follow after Jesus and to be his disciple, for him to be our rabbi, our teacher, our Lord, and us to be his disciple. And all the sermons have had some kind of a road, travel, journey theme with them. And so the sermon that was already planned out for this past Sunday, for yesterday, was the story of the Good Samaritan, the parable of the Good Samaritan, where Jesus tells a story about walking along the Jericho Road, which is the area that you kind of see behind me on the screen. And so that was already the sermon I was planning on preaching, but it certainly has tons of application for all that we're going through right now, and just the chaos and the uncertainty and instability in our world. So we're going to re-record this and publish it, post it to our through our website and on the Facebook as well, so that you can, if you had a difficult time watching it or following it yesterday, you can follow it there, and then certainly you can share it with other people as much as you feel led to do so. Let me start us off with a word of prayer real quick. Father, we just ask you that you would bless this message, from your word. Father, it has so much application for us at all times of our lives, but particularly now when there's so many different needs around us. And I know we feel sometimes helpless and kind of constrained because we might be stuck at home and unable to really to minister to others, but that's kind of the point, is that there's always something we can do. There's prayers that can be offered up, and it's so much about just having a heart of compassion for other people and being mindful of the needs and the suffering that others are going through. And so, Lord, I just pray that you would use this message, the thoughts that we share that come from your word, to be a blessing to those who will get to experience it. I just pray all these things in your son Jesus' name. Amen. It's no surprise that, and certainly no shock to anyone, that we live in a world that is that deals with these kind of this kind of brokenness. We live in a world that is rife with suffering and disease and sickness and death. And the reality is, these are all symptoms of living in a sinful and broken world. Now, we know both through God's word, but also through experience, that God can and does move in the midst of our suffering. And he often does his best work in our lives when we are experiencing suffering, if we'll let him. But make no mistake, the Bible does promise us that there will come a time when he will put an end to all pain, all suffering, all death, all disease, all sickness, once and for all. And we look forward to that time. We are excited about when that time will come, because we're reminded of God fulfilling his promises to us. But until that day comes, God's plan for administering care to those who are in need, whether it's physical, mental, emotional, and certainly spiritual, is more often than not to use his power, his healing power, through his people. God wants his best for all of his creation. So if we're working to see his will be done on earth as it is in heaven, then our desire should be to see God's best be revealed in all of our lives. But how do we love others effectively so that we're pointing them towards God's best for them? And is that always the same for each and every person? Does loving someone the right way involve just doing anything? Does loving someone the right way mean that we just give them everything they want? Or is it more about giving people exactly what they need? When doctors are preparing to enter into their careers, and I guess probably all healthcare professionals, but they are called to take something that's called the Hippocratic Oath. Not the hypocritic oath, but the Hippocratic Oath. And the core of the Hippocratic Oath was written by Hippocrates, who was an ancient Greek physician who lived approximately 400 years before the birth of Christ. Hippocrates believed that anyone who would offer care for the physical well-being of others should first commit themselves to always seeking to act in the patient's best interest. In fact, the first part of the Hippocratic Oath pledges the following: I will prescribe regimens for the good of my patients according to my ability and my judgment, and never do harm to anyone. So the first commitment that a doctor will make is to do no harm. The idea being that if someone is sick, the last thing you want to do is to make them worse in any way. So therefore, as a doctor, I would commit myself only to measures that would help make them better. Now notice, it doesn't say that the measures to improve their health might not hurt a little, or sometimes even a lot. I mean, for everything from drinking nasty cough syrup to getting a shot to more intensive procedures like surgeries or chemotherapy. Sometimes taking your medicine is not always pleasant, and sometimes pain is necessary in order to get well. So what does all this mean for you and me? How does this apply to loving people? Well, I think God wants us to make the same commitment to one another, to do no harm. You see, sometimes we have both the opportunity and the power to show love to someone, and we do nothing. Sometimes we don't take the time to minister to a person's real need. We just temporarily medicate the symptom by doing just anything. What pleases God and what can make a lasting, eternal difference in someone's life is when we practice godly medicine, good medicine. And that's what this means. Loving people well means doing the right thing at the right time for the right reasons. So in our Bible account today, we're going to be looking at a story that Jesus told in response to a pretty serious and significant question that he was asked. It's a story that many of us are probably familiar with. I'm sure you've probably heard before. At least, if nothing else, you've heard the term that comes from the story, and that is Good Samaritan. It is the parable or the story of the Good Samaritan that Jesus tells. What you may not have realized, though, is that this story was prompted by a question that was posed to Jesus once upon a time. So I'll be reading today Luke chapter 10, and we're going to be in verses 25 through 33. We're going to kind of break it into three different sections and unpack each section a little bit at a time as we go through. So beginning in verse 25 of Luke chapter 10, on one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" Jesus replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this, and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus told this story. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. And we're going to pause there for a second and give a little background and context for the story that we're reading. So it tells early on that this guy that comes and asks this question, Jesus, was a teacher of the law. He was a rabbi, and as often happened in the circumstances, he was coming to test Jesus. He was, it may or may not have been necessarily a trap, although many times when other teachers of the law, other Pharisees and scribes and priests would come and question Jesus, that's exactly what it was. They were trying to trap him in his words. But he comes to Jesus with a question that was often debated in these types of circles amongst rabbis, of all the commandments of God, which is the greatest? Now, Jesus, in his brilliance, lets the man answer his own question. That was not unusual for rabbis back in those days. You would often answer or respond to a question with another question to kind of show that you understood the first person's question, but you wanted them to go a little bit deeper. So Jesus' response was, well, how do you read it? What's your response? Before you hear from me, I want to know what your idea is. But I kind of also think Jesus believed this guy liked to hear himself talk, and so he knew the opportunity was right to hear what this man wanted to say. So he asks the man to respond, and the man answers correctly. And Jesus praises him, but yet also rebukes him at the same time. He says, that's a great answer. Now go and do it. Go and live it out. But the teacher wanted to justify himself. So maybe he felt like Jesus was showing him up in some way. And so he says, okay, well, I get to love your neighbors yourself, but Jesus, who is my neighbor? And really what he was wanting to know is, how can I do everything that I'm already doing and feel better about myself? Like, so where are the lines, Jesus? Who is it that I'm called to love, and who is it that I really don't have to love as much? Draw me some lines. Who is my neighbor? I need to know who's in and who's out. And so in order to illustrate his point, Jesus tells a story, and it is the story of the Good Samaritan. And as his setting, Jesus chose the area that you see behind me on our green screen, which was the Jericho Road, the road that led from Jerusalem down to Jericho. Now, this road in Hebrew is called Adumim, which is translated as the Pass of Blood. Now, there's a lot of places you might want to go hiking or walking or driving that have certain names, like highways that get named or certain trails that get named. If one was called the Pass of Blood, I'm guessing that's one you and I would probably tend to avoid for good reason. This was a dangerous road. There were a lot of twists and turns that led through this this kind of canyon area. It was an area where bandits could hide out and where an unsuspecting traveler could easily be robbed. And so Jesus chose this area specifically. He chose this location for his story because it was meant to symbolize our lives. Our lives have many twists and turns and things that we can't always see coming around the corner, like viruses that can create pandemics on the globe. And so the point he's trying to make is that life can be challenging, life can be difficult. We can't always see things that are coming our way. But beyond just the location, Jesus was also very intentional about the characters that he puts into his story. And so the first two characters we meet are a priest and a Levite. And of course, the third character that comes later is the Good Samaritan. The priest would have been somebody who officiated in the leadership of the temple services. A Levite would have been sort of a lay person, part of the tribe of Levi, and they would have been tasked with maintaining the temple and its elements and orchestrating the services. Both of these men would have served in a purpose of leading the people of Jerusalem and the Jews, by extension, in times of worship, in times of public corporate worship. Now, it was stipulated in their law that in order to serve in the temple, you had to be ceremonially clean, which means, and one of those things that went into that is that you could not touch a body that was either bleeding or a body certainly that was dead. And this man who had been brutalized on the road was certainly, he looked like he'd been, you know, beaten to the point of death, or he looked like he could be dying. And so I guess both these men could have justified their inaction by saying, well, I need to keep myself ceremonially clean for the good of the people that I'm going to serve. I need to pass by this gentleman so that I don't touch him and contaminate myself. But here's the deal. Jesus specifically says that these men were not traveling from Jericho to Jerusalem, but from Jerusalem to Jericho. So what that means is that these guys in that culture would have served on a rotation system in their duties with the temple. Even if they had been on duty, they would have finished with what they were doing. They were basically leaving church, leaving temple, leaving those worship responsibilities, and would not have been contaminating themselves or making themselves ceremonially unclean in any capacity. What Jesus is basically saying is these men had no excuse. They should have known better, and yet they didn't act better. They didn't. In fact, they acted worse. And so when we look at these two guys in the story, the first point we're going to make is we want to make sure that we, as the body of Christ, avoid being a bad neighbor. And when you're a bad neighbor, this is what happens when you choose to do nothing. When others are in need around you and you choose to do nothing. Now, I think there's a lot of excuses that sometimes we offer to make ourselves feel better about not doing anything or doing nothing. One excuse I think we oftentimes say is, well, I don't have the time. Now, that might be an excuse that is easy to kind of tap into because we live in a very rushed culture, a culture that seems like we're always kind of impatient and always on the go. And it may be true that you certainly didn't plan for that need to come up, but God did. And part of surrendering your life to God is surrendering your time, because whatever time we have is the time that God has allotted to you and allotted to me, and it's intended to be used for his purposes. It's kind of hard to believe that these two righteous men would be so heartless and so insensitive, but you and I both know that it can easily happen when we're only focused on ourselves, and we are so tunnel vision about accomplishing what I need to do when I need to do it. It's so easy to not be observant and miss the needs that are all around us. In 1973, there were two seminary professors who decided to recreate the circumstances of this parable, and they asked 40 of their students, so these seminary students, so at the time, young men who were training for careers in the ministry, training to be pastors, training to be preachers. They asked 40 of their students to walk to a particular building on this college campus for an interview with them. On the way to the building, they planted a victim of a robbery to see how their students, who were all training for the ministry, as I said, would react. 24 of the 40 students, so 60%, walked right past the victim some of them stepped over the victim in order to get to their appointment on time. Now, as sad as that story seems, and as callous as it seems, it's not unlike a lot of well-meaning, well-intentioned followers of Jesus Christ who oftentimes do the exact same thing when we see others in need around us. Listen, it is not wrong to be a planner. It's not wrong to want to be efficient with your time, and many of us have responsibilities and things we need to do. It is not a bad thing at all to enter into each and every day with a clear idea about what you hope to get accomplished. But we have to remember that God's a planner too, and God has a vision for how his day in your life needs to unfold so that you continue to grow into the you that he's always intended for you to be. And it is certainly like God in his nature to place troubling times and difficult people in your path in order for that to happen. God is the one who determines exactly how much time we need. So I would encourage you, and myself as well, that we need to pray for the willingness and the patience to accept God's plan for each day and the wisdom to see each moment and the potential that it has. Now, you may have committed your time to other responsibilities, things that would also please God. But I think if we're really honest about it, this time crunch that most of us feel, it's usually about pleasing ourselves and doing things on our own schedule far more than it is about honoring God and serving others. Now, another excuse that sometimes bad neighbors will use it beyond just the time issue is, well, I don't have the resources. I don't have the resources. I don't have anything. But the reality is there's always something that you can give. Now, if someone asks you for money, maybe you don't have it, or maybe that's not what their real need is. If someone asks you for time, you may not be free at that moment to give it to them based upon other responsibilities that you've already committed yourself to. But the reality is it takes little time and no money to genuinely carry that person to God's arms in prayer. All it really costs you is compassion. I love the story in the book of Acts where Peter and John are going by one of the city gates where a crippled beggar was asking for money. And Peter, who had left his profitable business of fishing to become a disciple for Jesus, which didn't pay nearly as well, he pulls out his pockets and he said, "I don't have silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk." Now, maybe you're thinking that you don't have those kinds of resources either, and no silver or gold at your disposal. But each of us has access to the power of God. Now, pray for others like you are walking them straight to the throne of God. You can't heal him, but he can. And no matter how he chooses to heal them, whether it be physically, permanently, physically, temporarily, but in his way and in his time, according to his will, God will move and act when his people pray. A third excuse that sometimes we use when we end up falling into that trap of being a bad neighbor is, well, I don't really have the heart. Well, if you don't have a heart for people, maybe that's why God continues to give you those opportunities. You know, sometimes our heart does grow cold and it gets callous to the suffering of others. Sometimes we see people in need and we go straight into judgment mode, right? You know, we say things like, well, he's clearly the cause of his own suffering, or if she didn't make so many foolish decisions, then she wouldn't be in this position to begin with. And I think that's where the priest and the Levite were in this story. And quite frankly, the teacher who asked Jesus the question to begin with, I think that's where he was. He was trying to get definitive lines. He wanted Jesus to draw those lines for him so he would know who he had to be kind to, who he had to show mercy to, and who he could basically neglect. And all of these men had become so comfortable in their self-righteousness that they positioned themselves to judge the misdeeds of others, and they're content to observe and just offer commentary on why these people deserve to suffer. Now listen, we don't need to always step in and remove people from the consequences of their bad decisions. If we do that, then sometimes people will never learn from their mistakes. However, I wonder, do we take the opportunity to offer counsel to those who find themselves in these broken patterns, these cycle of bad decisions? Now maybe they won't listen. Maybe they're not broken enough yet or humbled enough yet to accept help. But whenever Jesus encountered someone caught in sin, his first response was always to reach out in love and then point them away from their sin towards real life, towards lasting and eternal life. If you're struggling with having the heart to care for those who are in need, then maybe that's why God continues to send those people your way. Let's jump back into the text here to get to part two of the story, verses 33 and 35, where we meet the hero of our story, the Good Samaritan. So in verse 33, "But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense that you may have. A good Samaritan. You know, Jesus, again, intentional in everything he did, chose his hero wisely. He intentionally chose a Samaritan to be the hero of the story. Jesus knew his crowd. He was teaching and preaching to a mostly Jewish crowd, if not predominantly Jewish crowd, and knew the animosity that existed between Jews and Samaritans. And going back to the original question, this Jewish teacher and leader had said, who's my neighbor? Who are the people that I have to love, that I have to reach out to? And in making the Samaritan the hero of his story, Jesus is showing that the person that you despise, that you would look down on, actually is the one who learns how to show mercy at a greater capacity. Now, the Samaritan had plenty of reasons of his own to do nothing, but he acted. He acted. He chose compassion. He chose mercy. The word compassion in the original Greek that we see in the New Testament is a word that literally is translated as to spill your guts out for somebody, meaning that when I see you in pain, when I see you hurting, that I feel your pain in the very core of who I am, that the very core of who I am wants to reach out and touch or impact your life in some way. The scriptures say that he bound up the wounds of this man. He probably did that with his own clothes, maybe tearing off strips of fabric from his own robe, because it's very unlikely he was traveling around with a first aid kit of some kind. Said that he used wine as a disinfectant. He used oil to soothe the pain. He used the resources that he had to try to administer the care that he could. He put him on his own donkey. He led him to a place of lodging that where this man could be cared for. But then Jesus is very particular to say that the Samaritan then went off temporarily to fulfill his other responsibilities, but promised that he would come back and tend to the man at the next moment that he possibly could. Now, I want to pause and focus on that part of the story, because if there's a part of this story that ever gets neglected, I think it's that part there. And it's very small and maybe seeming kind of insignificant, and maybe it certainly doesn't seem like the lead of the story, but I think it's important. Jesus put it in there for a reason. I want to play a little what-if game for a second. I want to imagine, what if when the Samaritan gets this guy, the victim, to this lodge, to this inn, and says, I've got to go take care of my other responsibilities, what if the victim had protested and said, what, you're leaving me now? Now when I need you most? You can't leave me alone. And so what if the Samaritan, compelled by guilt, had chosen to stay? He would have missed his business deal in Jericho, potentially losing money, again, having no resources to continue to help this man to get better. And maybe he would even have had a growing resentment toward this man for his selfish request and regrets helping him in the first place. Does that sound like an experience that maybe you've had before when you've tried to help somebody out of the wrong motivation? It could easily happen. Now, it's not what happens here, but there's a reason why. There's a reason why that doesn't take place in the story that Jesus tells. Because the good Samaritan certainly wasn't a bad neighbor, but he also wasn't just a busy neighbor. Being a busy neighbor is what happens when we do just anything. Here's some of the things that we think about when we are simply just a busy neighbor. Somebody's in need, and we say or we think in our minds, I'll just give you whatever you want. But that's not what we're called to do. We're not called to simply give to wants. We're called to minister to needs. Now, if you have children, or you ever worked with children in any capacity, you know how foolish it is to give a child everything that that child wants. I mean, even as adults, what if we always got everything that we want? I know some people think life is meant to be lived that way, but that is not reality. It's a fantasy. I mean, there are times in life where, even as I would say this, we have to eat our vegetables. There are times in life where we've got to drink that Robitussin. We've got to get that cough syrup down. There's times in life we have to get that shot. There are times in life that we have to go through difficulty in order to be made well. We have to take the hard medicine, the difficult times, in order to get better. So when we're trying to give care to someone, sometimes that care comes across in the form of what might be considered or deemed tough love. There are times in life where we have to confront someone. There are times in life where we have to learn how to say no. There are times in life where we have to make hard decisions. To give in to wants without any consideration of what is God's best for that other person, that's not loving them well. If anything, it's borderline abuse. To make sometimes difficult decisions that may bring even temporary pain to that person, if it's in pursuit of God's best for them, that's not evil. It's not even being mean. That's true love. Love is not easy. And sometimes it has to be tough. It's doing not just anything, but the right thing at the right time for the right motives. Unfortunately, sometimes we also think as just a busy neighbor saying, well, they need something, I'll just give everything that I have. But we're not called to do that either. We're called to give according to our abilities. That's a phrase that comes from another parable that Jesus told about three servants who were each given a different portion of their master's property to manage. And the two of the servants that do their job well, they're commended by the master because they managed it according to their ability, according to that which had been entrusted to them by the master. So in this story, the Samaritan gave what he had to give in that moment. And once he had the man in a safe place with adequate care, he went on to take care of his other responsibilities. If he had neglected those responsibilities, that would have been just as careless of the Samaritan as it would have been if he had done nothing for the man that was injured. What's called here for us is the need for discernment. Discernment is what allows us to evaluate the situation with the wisdom of God. And so many times we plunge, you know, headfirst into a crisis without thinking or without ever taking a moment to understand what is the most appropriate and effective help that I can offer. We need to ask not only what is the need of the other person, but what ability has God given me in this moment to help meet it. Now, unfortunately, I think many of us don't give God enough credit for how able he actually has made us. I think we're too often like the third servant in that parable I mentioned a second ago, who was given a very small portion to manage and was afraid of losing it. And so he said to the master, listen, I don't want to lose your investment in me. So I just kind of sat on it. I went and buried it and hid it so that I'd have be able to give back to you. And if you recall that story, Jesus looked at that servant and said, get away from me, you wicked and evil servant. All of us are probably far more able to give and to minister to the needs of others than sometimes we like to admit. Jesus once said, from everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. And from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. Even the superhero Spider-Man understood that precept when he said that when he learned that with great power comes great responsibility. And in our nation and in our culture, we are some of the most affluent people who live on this planet. We have resources beyond the imagination of many people who exist on this planet. And so I think it comes back to us many times to ask, what can I give? What has God placed under my oversight and my management and my stewardship? What has he blessed me with that I can turn be a blessing to others? You know, God didn't give us blessing simply so we could be a receptacle of his blessing, but more that we could be a conduit of his blessing to flow into the lives of others. The last excuse I think sometimes we use when we're just simply being a busy neighbor is, well, I'll give because I have to. It's what a good Christian is supposed to do. So we give out of obligation. But true love is never given or administered that way. True love is always given freely, never under compulsion. The Samaritan had a number of reasons to not help this man, yet he was moved by compassion to do what he could when he could. No one else was around. I mean, he could have bypassed this guy just like the priest and the Levite did. In fact, you almost get the sense that if other people had been watching, then maybe the priest and the Levite would have acted because people would have seen them being compassionate, and they were looking for that kind of praise from man. And I think that's when you know when you're really loving someone or serving someone for the right reasons. When you love someone or you're serving with integrity, you do it without expecting anything in return. You do it whether somebody's watching you or not. I can remember early in our marriage, hopefully I've learned some lessons since then, but Erica had come home from teaching one day, and I'd gotten home before she was there, and I had unloaded the dishwasher, which typically is something that she did, but I wanted to kind of show an act of kindness, and so I unloaded the dishwasher, and I was thinking, like, I'm going to earn some serious husband points for this. And so when she got home, I maybe even left the dishwasher open so she could see that it was empty. I pointed out, hey, look at this nice thing that I've done for you. Don't I get some credit for that? You know, where's the praise for me unloading the dishwasher? And I think she promptly wanted to know where the praise was for like the thousand times that she had done it without getting any word of acknowledgement whatsoever. And that wasn't a real act of service. I was doing that to see what I could get from it. And that is not what a true good neighbor does. When you love others well, it must move from the inside out. True love is given freely. Or like the Apostle Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 9, remember this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having everything that you need, you will abound in every good work. So we don't want to be a bad neighbor. We don't want to be simply a busy neighbor. We want to be a good neighbor. So what does that look like according to the story that Jesus tells? Let's jump back into the text, these last couple of verses. He went, the Samaritan went to him, and he bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, took care of him. He provided for the resources for his care, and then went back. So when Jesus finished the story, he looked to the teacher who had asked him the question. And he said this, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? And the expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. And Jesus told him, now go and do likewise. So Jesus finishes his parable, and he turns back to this teacher of the law and says, which of these men was a true neighbor? But you know, that's not the question that the lawyer had asked at the beginning. And that's the point of the whole story. The teacher of the law wanted to know who he had to love. He wanted Jesus to draw the line for him. But here's Jesus' point. Instead of worrying about who is or who isn't your neighbor, simply be a good neighbor. Don't waste your time figuring out who you should love. Be love to others. Respond to the needs of others in whatever way you can, when you can. The teacher of law wanted to make sure he had correct theology and correct doctrine, and that is important. But correct theology without right behavior, in Jesus' eyes, is worthless. So how do we become good neighbors? To be a good neighbor means that this is what happens when we do the right thing. We choose to do nothing and not just to do anything, but when we do the right thing. And when we choose to do the right thing, people are blessed. People experience healing as they are touched by the reality of God's love that is shown through you and me. I mean, how is it possible that lost people can connect to an invisible God? Well, that happens when they see the real and tangible evidence of that God at work through each and every one of us. You know, here at First Christian Church, our mission is to love God, love people, and lead them to Christ. And that's not unusual. Hopefully, that's kind of the mission of every church. It may word it a little bit differently, but that's based upon what we call the great commandment that we read in this story, to love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, love people, love your neighbors yourself, but also the great commission, to make disciples of all nations. And until people know that you love them, they're not going to want to be led to your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, until they know that his love is actually legit in you, that it's real, that it's tangible, because they've seen it at work. And so when we choose to be good neighbors to those around us, not because they deserve it, not because they've been nice to us, but simply genuinely because God's love is working inside of us, flowing out of us, then people are blessed for that, and they know that God is real. Secondly, when we choose to be good neighbors, it means that we're becoming a better version of ourselves. You continue to grow into a better version of you, which is more and more and more like Jesus. If we're going to grow up as his disciples on this journey that we're on with him, if we're going to become mature and complete, become more like Jesus, then that means his love for others is going to be seen more clearly and evidently through us. You know, you might have other role models in your life, people that you look to as examples, and that's great. Hopefully they're good role models, who've set good examples for you. But God's goal for you and for me is to make us more like Jesus, and he's willing to do whatever it takes for that transformation to take place between here and heaven. And finally, when we are good neighbors to those around us, we see that people are blessed. We become more of the people that God wants us to be. But maybe most importantly, God's kingdom is extended and grown, and his name is glorified. This is the true picture of God's kingdom here on earth. You know, so many times the church in our culture gets misrepresented, and I don't mean by the media or by people who resent the church. I'm talking about Christians themselves who wear the name of Christ, who are called to represent God, and yet we don't love like him. But when we choose to act with responsibility and compassion, that's when people get a true glimpse of God's glory revealed in us and through us. God gets the credit. People are exposed to his truth. But it only happens when we love people by doing the right thing at the right time for the right reasons. So I just want to ask you some questions today. Usually in my sermons every week here at First Christian, we always have some next steps. Like, now that you understand the truth, hopefully, here's how you can apply that into your everyday life. And so I want to get you some questions to prompt some thought for you. First of all, do I take notice of opportunities that God puts before me to be a living example of his love? you know, right now we're having to practice this social distancing and be very isolated from each other. We don't get a lot of physical contact with one another right now, but there are still ways that you can bless others. Sometimes you can be a little more creative with it, and we do it through technology like we're doing right now. But do I take notice of opportunities? Do I think about those who oftentimes get forgotten? Am I truly exercising every chance that I can to be a living example of his love? Number two, do I love freely without prejudice? And it's very easy to allow those prejudices sometimes we're brought up with or raised with that are ingrained in us to prevent us from reaching out to those who might seem different from us in any way because they dress differently, they speak a different language, their skin color is different from mine, they roam in a different socioeconomic group, they have different tastes, different interests, even different beliefs. You know, we're not simply called to love and serve those who love and serve God. We're called to love all and serve all, even those who may never turn to God. And that brings to the third question. Do I love unconditionally? You know, that's kind of where the teacher was who prompted this question, prompted the story, who asked this question of Jesus. You know, do I love unconditionally? Or, like the teacher, do I only love those who love me? Am I only kind to those who are kind to me? Do I only treat those with kindness, those who deserve it? What if God chose to love us that way? What if God only loved those who really genuinely deserved his love and grace? Then all of us would be out of luck, right? None of us deserve God's love. None of us are worthy of God's grace. And that's the point. He showers it upon us because of his love for us. We don't have to earn God's love. We don't have to earn God's favor. God loves us simply because we are his creation. And our love for others is supposed to be shown in the exact same way. And the last question is, do I love responsibly? Loving someone well doesn't mean always giving them exactly what they want. Loving someone well means sometimes making some tough decisions or sharing some hard truths with them, but speaking that truth in love. The parable of the Good Samaritan has been called one of the most beautiful stories ever told, and its influence has spread far beyond the church itself. We even have, at least here in America, we have Good Samaritan laws that encourage citizens to act in the best interest of those who are in danger in the most appropriate way possible. But there's a hidden story in this parable that we sometimes miss. Many, many years ago, way back into the early history of the church, back into even to the second century, St. Irenaeus of France and St. Clement of Alexandria both saw the Good Samaritan as symbolizing something bigger when it comes to the larger story that God has been telling since the beginning of time. And it goes like this. The man who was going down from Jericho to from Jerusalem to Jericho represents Adam and the sins, the fall of man. Jerusalem represents paradise, and Jericho represents the world. The robbers in the story are the hostile powers, the things that afflict us and come after us, and they can lead us into temptation. The priest represents the law. The Levite represents the prophets. And the Samaritan is represented in the person of Jesus Christ. The wounds of the man who is beaten and left for dead, his wounds represent our disobedience, our sin against God. The donkey, in many ways, represents the Lord's body because the scriptures tell us that we were thrown upon the shoulders. Our sins were cast upon the shoulders of Jesus as he led him away to the cross at Calvary. The inn, which accepts all those who enter, is representative of the church. The manager of the inn who accepts the wounded man is the head of the church, who would be Jesus Christ, to whom its care has also been entrusted. And the fact that the Samaritan promises he will return represents the second coming of Jesus Christ. It's beautiful to think about, isn't it? That what Jesus instructs us to do while we're waiting for his return is emblematic of who he is and what he will do when he returns to wipe away every tear, to put an end once and for all to all pain and suffering and death and sickness and coronaviruses and everything else that might afflict us today. Until that time comes, the church, his body, is called to be his instrument of healing and peace and caring into this broken world. And I hope you and I will take that calling seriously. Thank you for joining me on this rebroadcast of our sermon. I hope this is a blessing to you. And if you've been blessed by it, certainly feel free to take and share this video with others. It also might be an encouragement to them. Let me close this with a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, again, thank you for this beautiful story, this powerful story that you told so many years ago that has such real-world, real-life application to us here and now. Lord, we sit again, we just lift up all those who are being impacted through the chaos and the craziness all around us right now. We specifically pray for those who are sacrificially giving of their time and resources and putting their own health on the line to battle against this. We pray for our healthcare professionals. We pray for our first responders and that you keep them safe. We pray for their families who might, they might be being pulled away from their families right now, our military that are stepping in and helping in different areas. We pray for our government officials, Lord, that are exercising wisdom with and maturity in the decisions that they're making for us. We pray for our educators who are having to learn new ways to educate and to lead our kids who have been taken out of their normal school environments in the time being. Pray for all of our churches that are trying to be creative in ways we can engage with those that we serve in the communities where we are. And Lord, just for everyone that's involved and is impacted by this, we know there are many who have lost loved ones, and their grief has been complicated because they can't even have funeral services for these loved ones yet, and the challenges that has created. So Lord, those who might be losing jobs, businesses, Lord, there's such a need for compassion, for your love, for your peace to be felt. And Lord, we as your people, we as your body, we as your church, Lord, we want to be instruments of that to others. Lord, just we pray your blessing and your comfort to be upon us as a land, as a people, as your world. And Lord, that people will, through this a time of adversity, they'll turn back to you unlike any other time in history, Lord. This will be a great awakening for people to recognize that they desperately need a relationship with you that's only found through Jesus. And Lord, it's in Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys.